Welcome to Rascal Apiary, and today we're going to walk you through setting up your property to maximize honey production throughout your beekeeping season. In 340 BC, Aristotle observed that honeybee workers visit flowers of only one flower type during a foraging trip. This is known as flower constancy and has been shown to occur in a wide range of insect pollinators. Honeybees are a big celebrity to us humans because of their flower constancy trait gives us honey. Since the bees stick to only one type of flower until the flower type runs out of nectar, bees are able to store uniquely tasting nectar that is then dehydrated and turned into honey. That's why you can find light honey and dark honey. Sometimes honey that smells like oranges, and other times it smells like a dirty teenager sock. Okay, you're watching this video to find out what you can do to set up your property for your bees that you're going to install this spring. If you're looking for where to place your beehive, check out this video, choosing the perfect location for your beehive. Everything I'm going to talk about roots back to flower constancy. So you have to be able to understand this. I believe that this is how we keep our bees happy and healthy. First, if you're still in winter or at the tail end of winter, check out this book, 100 Plants to Feed the Bees by Xerxes Society. A link will be in the description if you want to buy the book. It supports the channel at no extra cost to you. So just use our link. What our plan was when we started this was to sit down, go through the book, highlight all the flowers that grow in our zone. Then we started looking at which insects the flowers attract. So who's going to go there? Something you should know about honeybees is if other insects really target the flowers that you have out there, the honeybee scouts will look at other sources. An example of this is a bumblebees all targeting your Dutch clover. The bees will look for basil instead, even if you have more Dutch clover than the basil. They just don't like how the bumblebees treat the plants. That's something I learned after hours of being in the yard. You just walk out there, observe, and you'll start to notice this going on. All right, so we've been going through the book. We'll highlight all the bee plants that grow in our zone, like I said, and you'll see we have a couple of choices. What we then did was separated the trees from the flowers. We looked at how many insects would be on our plants. We eliminated the heavy trafficked plants by other insects. We were then left with plenty of awesome plants on our list that mainly honeybees would forage off of. It sounds like a pretty solid list. And what we did is we went out and we found a local farming store near us that had all the seeds that we needed. Score. However, did you know that bees can visit up to 5,000 flowers in a single day? If you think that's amazing, consider this. To make 1 pound of honey, a hive must travel over 55,000 miles and visit 2 million flowers for a pound. 5,000 flowers. How am I going to plant that many? Well, it turns out I don't really have to. What we needed is to plant about an acre of cover crop and have seasonal crops as well. What we ended up choosing was crimson and Dutch clover for spring, which we would plant in late winter. Since spring is pretty easy and everything blooms, there's nothing really to worry about. Summer is typically a dearth, so there's not much out there for the bees. So in the middle of the honey flow, I'll go out and I'll sow in a bunch of sunflower seeds, specifically red sunflower. These pop up about a week into the summer and will feed the bees pollen into late fall or into the fall. We also plant zinnias, basil, mint, and let those things run wild until grass starts growing real tall, and then I'll mow. But as fall approaches, nothing to worry about because goldenrod will start popping up, and in everybody's yard goldenrod pops up. So within the next 3 to 5 miles, no problem. Here's a rough diagram of our backyard. We have a couple of red maples, cherry trees, and peach trees. And then we have 15 to 20 tulip poplars in the back. And after a couple of years of beekeeping, I realized trees have more pollen and nectar and propolis than flowers ever could. And they're the biggest producers. Next, we have areas where we plant meadows. I use my grapes and hops to serve as windbreaks. Then I have a garden that's for us, and it's just a bunch of garden boxes where we'll plant anything from corn to strawberries, a variety of vegetables, just anything that we want to eat. So after listening to this, you may be starting to wonder, will the bees actually pollinate your garden? Because honestly, that's what most beekeepers want. And the answer is probably not. You'll see the bees on your garden plants once in a blue moon. If that's what you're really looking for, you're kind of better off looking into mason bees and leafcutter bees. They forage about 300 feet from wherever their home is. Unlike honeybees, honeybees will forage anywhere 3 to 5 miles. Difference is, honeybees will produce a ton of honey for you. They also use your garden, your neighbor's garden, everything else. Key notes when setting up your apiary, select the right cover crop for you. Something you don't mind seeing in your apiary. I recommend starting with crimson and Dutch clover. It doesn't grow very tall, and it gives you the best opportunity to hang out with your bees, and you get to see them forage a lot, and that's a lot of fun. I suggest whatever you choose to plant for summer be specifically for honeybees and grows during summer, blooms specifically. Thanks for watching our video. If you liked the video, share it with your friends, share it with your beekeeping group, just tell somebody. My question for you that made it to the end is, which type of beekeeper are you? Are you a treatment-free beekeeper? Do you have a treatment schedule? Do you just monitor? What do you do? How do you stop Varroa? Let us know in the comments. Thanks, and I'm buzzing off.